poor and powerless, and all the lost and lonely. All the thieves will come confess and know that you are holy. We'll know that you are holy. We will sing.
Ah.
for your faithfulness. Some of the youth come up and share a song with us.
Hello, check. So this song is really. It's a song that kind of was an anthem throughout winter camp, and that's what we're kind of doing this morning. Is it's going to be a youth-led service. We want to kind of give you an insight, a slice into what winter camp was, and how blessed we were because you guys picked up the tab. You know. But, you know, whether parents paid for your kids or through fundraisers that we always do and all that stuff, it's a body, right? There's things we can't do. There's things you can do. There's things you can't do that they can do, you know. I mean, this next generation can reach people that you can't. I can't, you know. I mean, through Snapchat, we don't even know how to use that. Some of us know what it is. But we just want to... sing this song with you guys and want to come up. It's a fairly simple song, but it's super powerful because of the lyrics, because of the heart behind it, that God is a good, good Father. And to be able to know that and sing it, yeah. I mean, so just sing with us, and we want to lead you guys in this song as you come up. Yeah, if there's any youth kids that went or even didn't go, you want to come up and sing, feel free to do that. So there we go. All right. Yeah. There we go. Yeah. I don't know if there's anyone. Awesome.
Oh. Lord Jesus, you are good. You are good. You give us blessings, God, that we don't deserve. Your grace is insurmountable, God. We thank you. We praise you, Lord God, for what you've done in these kids' lives, Lord Jesus. And we pray, God, that you would burn even more so, God. We pray, God, that you would take over their lives, Lord Jesus. Passion burning and stirring. Lord Jesus, may that happen to this church, God. In all of us, Lord Jesus, that it would just cause a chain reaction, God. That we would all just have such a yearning for you, Jesus. And just because we're not at camp or we're not with all other people who have the same desire, Lord Jesus, may that fire burn even brighter, God. May we pursue you, God, because you pursue us daily. Father, we pray that you would open up our eyes, Jesus. Open up our hearts, Lord Jesus. If there's anything that we're dragging behind us that does not belong, Lord Jesus, we pray that you would tear us free from it right now, Lord Jesus. That we would surrender it all to you, God, and trust you. So, Father, you are good. And we praise you. We praise you for who you are in us, God. Who you are to us, Lord Jesus. So, Father, have this time. Do away with it as you will, God. We give you our lives. We give you our hearts, Lord Jesus. And we love you, God. And we praise you. And we worship you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Yeah. Yeah. All right, guys. It's going to be a takeover soon. Greet one another. Sorry, guys. Go ahead and stand, greet one another. That's what we do. Awesome. Grab a seat. Good morning, everybody. It was cold in here like 25, 30 minutes ago. It's really warm now. I don't think our heater's that good. I think it's because there's so many people in here. And
Holy Spirit,
there we go. Turn up the heat. So good to see you guys. Good morning. So we just got a cool Sunday for you guys. We want to give you some insight, like I said, into camp, into just the blessing it was for those that went. And we want to let you guys see a little bit of that fruit, just here and also as a church as we continue. And God will continue to do his thing. It's amazing. And we'll be able to all partake of just what he's doing. So good morning. Welcome to Calvary. And we have to open up a quick video. Oh, no, my bad. Well, we got some announcements. I didn't write it on my hand. We have some announcements this morning that we're gonna hit real quick. So we have the men's study starting back up. So, yeah. If you're a man or you're on your way to manhood, biblical manhood probably start at like 12. But I would say if you're like 16 and up, you want to, 16, 18, you want to come, you're welcome to come. Obviously, though, men, we want you there. We want to cover real life issues. We're going through the book of James. Brent's going to be leading us through that. It's going to be awesome. Huge blessing. It's starting at 6:30 on Monday nights here.
Tomorrow
is the first night. It's starting here at the church, and dinner is available. So it's like a basket if you want to help pitch in for that, but dinner will be available. Dinner's available, right, Sean? Dinner?
Yes,
okay.
Alan.
What?
Alan.
Dinner, okay. So yeah, and I just threw a verse at the bottom, Proverbs 27:17, as iron sharpens iron, so a man sharpens the countenance of his friend. So many things I like about that verse, but that's what God does there, is men get together, they get to talk candidly about life, about being a man, be real with one another. We get to go through the Word and have that fine-tune us and sharpen us and build us up in who God wants us to be. So I'm going to call Jazz up for the next announcement.
Wow. Kizzy. Okay, good morning. Okay, so I just have a quick announcement about the Married Couples Valentine's event. We will be having a spaghetti dinner, and we will have a showing of the movie The War Room. And if you guys haven't seen it, go find the trailer. It's going to be very powerful. It's all about prayer in marriages. And if anybody's engaged, you guys are welcome to come as well. The cost is $20 per couple, which for Valentine's, I'm sorry, but that's like a steal. And it's going to be on February 13th at 6 p.m. So that's when it's going to begin. We will have childcare for a small fee. So let me know if you guys are interested. I sent out an e-vite a couple days ago. I know that there are some of you guys in here that I don't have your email addresses if you're a married couple or engaged couple. So come see me or Shiva. Shiva's waving her hand. The event will be here at the church. So come see me for more information. God bless.
And so we just threw at the bottom right here, Saturday morning prayers at 8 a.m. at the church. Just because I've heard the movie The War Room makes you want to pray. So just figured we'd slide that in. It's not like part of the event per se, but there it is. So a lot of information. That's good. All right, we have a video we're going to share, show about camp, a couple minutes long, so hit the lights, and then we'll get this started.
Let's hear it.
You sent yourself.
Fuck yeah!
to it, swallow it. Oh my God, that is awesome. Awesome. Yeah, so camp was a really great time. Thank you guys so much for your prayers. And even I know emails get sent out a lot, kind of these email blasts. And sometimes it's like, did anyone get that? But with camp, when we were talking about camp, there was a lot of replies going back and forth. It's like, oh, okay, people are reading it. All right. It's being seen. And then it was communicating. So it was great. So we just appreciate everything, and camp was such a blessing. And I wanted to just invite some of the students up. If you guys want to share, if you went, just think about something you might want to say. But I want to have Nish and Emily come up and talk just a few minutes about camp and what the Lord showed them and did to them.
Ladies.
Pastor's rules.
Do you not want to go first? You can go first.
Huh? I'll go first.
That's how we do it again.
Yeah.
Good morning.
Do I need a mic?
I don't think so. Oh, thank you. It was so good. I haven't been to an organized youth camp in a long time.
Hey.
No, not that kind. No, like a kind where it's together with other churches since... When was that? Like 2009?
Yeah,
a while ago. Yeah, it was good. We went with a couple other churches. It was super duper fun. The girls and I up really late. But we got into some really good conversation. I was really blessed by the maturity of your kids. I want to say thank you, parents, first of all, for raising such wonderful kids. Because I was watching all the other youth groups. I'm like, ours is so gracious. No, but also, like, they were really friendly. But they are also, the theme of the camp was holy. And I saw a lot of amazing, like, testimony of, like, their growth into holiness. Because it's a journey. Like, they, like, what was the pastor? Oh, Nate. Nate Holdridge was saying that sanctification is a process. And definitely I've seen that in all of you guys, and I was so excited, and I got a word from the Lord about growth for the kids at camp, and it was a vision of a beautiful flower, and it looked fine, but the roots were all mold and gross, and it wasn't, it was dying, and I never wanted to see our kids be that way, but I don't see any of you guys being that way. I see so much growth, and I'm so blessed to know each one of you. You all taught me something, and I'm just so blessed by your kids. I really am, and personally, I was just quiet. I don't know if you guys know this, but I lost my voice for like 5 days. I was whispering. If you guys know me, I'm really loud. But I literally, I had to talk like this. And when I had to get their attention, I literally did this for like 10 seconds and no one listened until then. But it was good. But in the silence, I did learn a lot about who God is. And that was my takeaway from camp, I guess. But yeah, super blessed by you guys. Thank you for all your prayers. We made it safely there. I think I was the only one who got sick afterwards from all the rain. But yeah, super blessed by the camp, so.
Awesome.
Good, thank you.
Morning, church, how you guys doing?
Good.
Sweet. So, Jason asked me to share at least a week ago, and I was just pouring over my notes from camp, and one thing popped up in my notes, and it said, our mission is to go into the world and let your light shine amongst men. And one of the things we did during camp, we, even though we had like all like four or five different churches there, we had a time set aside specifically just for our church, because we were kind of like catered to our church's needs and our kids and everything. And Emily and I both shared, and the thing that I shared about was camp is like, I'm kind of a dork. I like, you know, the knights in shining armor and swords and all that, and this is what I shared on that Sunday. And I was like, you know, I like that kind of thing. And camp is like that. It's where all the knights and all their horses and everything gather up and get into this stronghold, this castle. But the battle isn't done at the castle. The battle is done in the valleys, mm-hmm. which is right here at home. Mm-hmm. So here at home is where the valley, is this valley where the battlefield is, and this is where the most fruit grows. And we, as parents, as leaders, as different influences on our kids, we definitely need to be all the more on our knees for these kids so that they can thrive in this battlefield, because they are in a battlefield. We are at war, guys. We need to be at war with for our kids, because there is so much going on in the world right now. So much pain, so much anger. And we are the light. We need to be the light shared amongst men and women and children amongst everyone. We need to be that light, because we are called to be salt and light. And that's pretty much what I shared about that day.
Amen. Are the kids coming?
Awesome. Does anyone want to come up and share something? Yep, all right.
Stage time today.
Here you go, bro.
So I just want to share on church, the camp. The camp was really touching to me. It was my first winter camp since I've moved back, thankfully. So it was really good. It was really fun. We learned a lot about everyone who goes to youth here. First of all, I want to say thank you to the leaders. People are just crazy, man. Without them, yeah. Give it up, man. Such role models. They really make us want to be like them when we're older. And that's what really meant a lot to us. They were just all day, every day, just keeping us in check. That's why we were so good.
You guys saw the headlock.
Yeah, Niche doesn't mess around. And then, so yeah, it was really fun. Grateful, it was really a good time to be out, especially for teenagers. Teenagers nowadays, guys, it's crazy, let me tell you. It's insane. It's really good how they were teaching us everything. Not to take stuff away from it, with it too. We weren't just there for the weekend, just on a little vacation. It was a teaching. It was a little class. It was something that we're gonna use later in life and longer and longer and longer. And that's what was really good about it. It was really fun. It was joyful the whole time. I think my cheeks were hurting the whole, like when I was going to sleep, just smiling all day. So it was really fun, yeah. I'm surprised I didn't lose my voice. I was screaming more than Emily. Yeah. And then I was making fun of her because I didn't lose my voice. So sorry about that. But, yeah, so it was a really fun time. I just want to say thank you for church being able to let us do it, and look forward to some more times.
Can you give us one of those screams?
Oh, no, I'm not ready for it. It's the fight.
Thank you. Yeah, awesome.
I really enjoyed winter camp, mainly because we got to bond with other churches and just get in worship and fellowship together. And I just also really grew close to my youth group and the girls and everyone. And I just love the bonding and just that one, like, we all got to worship as sisters and brothers in Christ. And but I also like how we got to mingle and meet other churches just like us and get to know them a bit. So that was my favorite part.
Awesome.
Got it? I feel you.
It'll work nicely.
Okay, so I actually prepared something, but then Niche like took my story that I was gonna talk about.
It's all right, reiterate it.
But so I'll just talk about like what I really enjoyed during camp. So Clay and I we basically did all the activities together, and do you guys know what like Kajabi Can-Can is?
Yeah.
So everyone basically holds a piece of rope that's knotted on both ends, and then you get in a circle around a garbage can or like whatever like you have, and the goal is to like make everyone else touch the garbage can until there's only one person standing. And in one round it was only Kalea and I who were the last ones, so I was like, whoa, this is weird, because like we're from the same church, so like we thought it was like until the last church stood, but apparently we had to verse each other, so I was like, this is cool. But it was really but it was really funny, because like we kept like adjusting our hands on the ropes, because we were like, I want to make this a fair fight, not like about who like lets go of the rope, but like who actually made the other person touch the can, which was really cool, because it was kind of scary, because I was like, Kalea is more like, she had more grip on the floor because she had hiking shoes on and I had like some flat chucks on. So that was a bit difficult, but it was really fun. And
what was the danger level on that
game? Oh goodness! Like, okay, so the dirt was all like muddy, and from all the people playing, it became like it was like no grass from where people were walking. So it was so slippery and muddy. And best part was doing everything in the rain, which I would have gotten killed by from my parents for doing that if they were there. But they didn't find out because I didn't get sick, so yeah. Oh. It was really fun. And just want to thank you for everyone just want to thank everyone who supported us and funding and like prayers and everything. So yeah. Thank you.
There were so many things in this entire camp that was really fun. But my favorite part was being in worship. It was just amazing. And there, I'm so sorry for the car ride. We were so loud. It was fun though. So there were just two events that I liked the most, and it was probably the Bean Boozled thing that Jason. I got booger and Mateo's got in 3 seconds. And so And then the second one was the dodgeball, and it was 6-5-0. My brother dodged so many. He was the last person standing. And, oh wait, there's one more. It was the can thing. And I got placed with like the biggest people, and it was a big mistake because it, my arm still hurts. I'm never doing that again. But I thought it was really fun, and Niche was the best camp cabin leader that there ever was. Mainly because he let us stay up till like 1 o'clock. Playing Mafia, and we killed off Alion like twice. We were like, you know what? I feel like Alion is the murderer, so we're gonna just kill him. And one time he wasn't even the murderer, we just killed him off. Is Alion here? He's not, right? We're sorry about that. We just felt like, hey, we were right though. We're right. We're done.
So you had a good time?
Yeah.
Awesome. Glad you made it. Is your brother here? Okay. Cool. Awesome. All right. That's all for this morning. I'm just kidding. So we're going to be in Colossians 2. I'll spend the rest of the time sharing kind of my heart regarding the youth overall, the church. The title of the message is It Takes a Church. And apparently there's some weird show that came out a while ago titled this. But anyway, don't let that distract you. No, it probably is. But so Colossians 2. Where we're going to be at. It's a verse JP read this morning. Can you guys stand with me as we read this verse? Honor God's word. Colossians 2, verse 6 and 7. I think the ushers, if you don't have a Bible, the ushers will get you one. And if you don't have a Bible, you can keep that Bible. It's a gift from us. There's also a lot of apps that you could use for Bible, but Colossians 2, 6, and 7 says, "Therefore, as you received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk in him, rooted and built up in him, and established in the faith, as you have been taught, abounding in it with thanksgiving." Lord, I thank you so much for the opportunity to serve you. God, the opportunity to know you, Lord, that we can know you as a good, good Father. That song just wasn't written by mistake, Lord. It resonates with us and those that know you, that have relationship with you. Lord, that your Spirit somehow dwells within us. God, that you bring dimension to our lives. God, you bring purpose and hope and promise, Lord God. And we thank you, God, that we can know you. Lord, I thank you that you've called us all to do this together. Father, and I thank you for what you're doing. Lord, for the youth, God, the work you're doing in their lives. God, the call that you have upon their life. Or to your workmanship. And you have good works before them that they would just walk in them. And for us as well as a church, collectively and together, and when we do separate and go our different ways throughout the week, Lord, there's a work that you want to do in all those circumstances, at all those times. And so, Lord, I thank you for this morning. I thank you for what was shared. I thank you that we could put together a video and just have that technology and cameras on our phones, and just, Lord, being able to grab those moments and save them for later and play them. God, and I just pray that you'd be glorified this morning. God, I pray that your word would be honored. Lord, that your church would be encouraged, equipped. Lord, may you do in us what you've been desiring to do from the foundations of the world. And may this morning be a piece of that. And pray this in Jesus' name. Everybody said,
amen.
Amen. All right. All right. So the camp was great. The theme was sanctified. And sanctification, walking in holiness, just getting to know the Lord, growing more and more into the person God wants you to be. We're walking more in righteousness and holiness, and this camp was great for me. It was probably the last camp I'll lead as youth pastor, and just I tried to soak up all that time with it. I tried to, man, just, I mean, I've done a lot of camps. You know, it was a beautiful time. And this verse, Colossians 2, 6, and 7, is when I think about the youth, my heart for what has been for the youth. I've been here serving with the youth. Tons of memories and stories and lives that have come and gone. So I've been serving with the youth here for 12 years, which is a long stay as a youth pastor. And usually they say the average youth pastor stays 2 years, and then it's sometimes uses the step to the next rung. And I never saw it as that. I never wanted to use it as that because, just face it, it's a lot of fun hanging out with the youth. You know, you get a bunch of youth together, you get a bunch of adults. You know, I'm just kidding. But you know, it's exciting. It's a pivotal time in everybody's life going through there. There's just a lot that can be sowed and invested and encouraged. And so when I think of the youth, this has been the verse that has been on my heart for the youth. And with the transition coming up, this dovetails just really nice into the church as a whole. Every person has their place. You know, if you're part of this church or you're in Christ, you're a Christian, you're following Jesus, you have a place within the body of Christ. You know, and that's the analogy used for it. It's not, we're not some museum here where we're just come, we sit, we do nothing, or here, and then we go, and we don't do anything. It's we're the body. Every person in Christ plays a role, has a function, and it's vital. You know, if there's one part of my body that just wanted to stop working, it could be pretty bad. You know, my big toe just wanted to leave. Though he's like, I'm always covered up by shoes, you know, all this, whatever. I wouldn't be able to walk, you know, falling over, there's no balance. So every part is important. And that's the analogy used. And so I'm excited because I just want, you know, just this opportunity to be able to share my heart, what's been for the youth, and how the church collectively together, how God has something for us all. Yes, this Sunday is youth focused, but that God would use these verses for all of us because it's in the book of Colossians. It's in the Bible. It's not in just a youth Bible. It's for all of us, and we all can glean and gain from this. And it's not only for the youth. It's for everybody in Christ. And he says, as therefore you have received Christ Jesus the Lord. So he's, in the book of Colossians, he's speaking to Christians, as therefore you have received Christ. So this is talking to those in Christ, those who are Christians. And the good works that want to flow from this and everything that God wants to pour in after these verses will only apply to those who have received Christ. And if you have not received Christ this morning, if you don't have a relationship with him, if you're like, that good father sound kind of weird, you know, then God has the invitation for you to become a son or a daughter, to receive Christ. And this says, as you have received him, we receive Christ by faith. We receive him by faith. John 1:12 says, but as many as received him, to them he gave them the right to become children of God, to those who believe in his name. So you believe in his name, you receive Christ, he gives you the right, the honor, the privilege to be called a child of God. That's amazing. We receive by faith. If you've ever wanted a good definition for faith biblically, write down Hebrews 11:1. Hebrews 11:1 says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. And I love this biblical definition of faith because oftentimes we hear faith, we hear the word faith, and we're like, oh, faith is some whimsical, just light, fluttery, floaty thing that just, you know, when life gets serious, you can't rely on faith because it's like here and there, it's in the air, you don't know, you can't grasp it. But I love the biblical definition of faith because that's entirely opposite of what the biblical definition of faith is. It says faith is the substance, like tangible stuff. Like you can rest in this. The Greek word for that is actually hypostasis, which means that which has actual existence, substance, a real thing. So faith is substance. It's the substance of things hoped for. And I've studied Hebrews 11:1 for a long time. And I always try and grasp it. Like, I want to grasp this verse fully, because I don't, substance, hoped for, evidence, you know, I don't fully know even how to put it together after years of studying this verse. And I always try to pin it down, it kind of squirms out. It's like, man. But it's beautiful how biblical faith is this. There's an element of like, I don't want you to pin it down. I want you to trust. And those things you hope for, you'll watch those materialize. Those will become substance. And then your faith will be stronger for the next time. Right? The Bible says we walk by faith and not by sight, right? And so that verse is an encouragement to us that when we do walk by faith and then there's substance there, we're like, oh man, God honored his word. God was there for me. What do you think is going to happen the next time you step out in faith? It's going to be based on who God is, his character, what he's done, right? So it's a substance of things hoped for. It's the evidence of things not seen. Throws in, so we have substance and we have evidence. Beautiful combination of what biblical faith is. Both of those words, most people would not think are in the definition for faith. But God's called us to trust him and walk with him. And when you do walk with him and trust and walk by faith and not by sight, your faith will grow. You will get stronger in it. I love the picture of faith because we can't even see looking forward, right? Like, tomorrow, we don't know what's going to happen. So we want to walk by sight and put all the pieces together, but we don't know. We don't know. God's outside of time, and I love the picture of him outside of time saying, I already see the beginning. I already see what's going to happen. Trust me. I got you. I got you. You know, your kid at the pool, hey, jump, jump. I got you. You know, my kids, when they would hesitate to jump, I'm like, really? Like, do you see these? You know, come on, just jump. You know, even time after time, it's like, I've caught you every time. Really? We're doing this again? Like, you know, when have I once dropped you? And you know, I kind of can sense the Lord the same thing. Like, I've come through for you. When you step out in faith, hey, I've come through. And yet we get to those points of, oh, I want to see it. I want to put it all together. And God's like, I already see what's going to happen. I've already written them all in a book. Psalm 90 says that he's written our whole lives in a book already, which is amazing. And so it's that's what faith is. So just as you've received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk in him. That's how we receive him, by faith. That's just the intro. And it says, so walk in him. Just as you've received him, now walk in him. Right? We're to walk in him. And I always think of this. I've probably mentioned this so many times, but I can't shake it. And this somewhat dates me, but Indiana Jones. Anybody with me on Indiana Jones? All right, I see. All right. Some youth have seen that movie. Is that like a classic?
Yes.
Like old, right? Like Harrison Ford way before he is now in the new Star Wars. That was when he was young, action star. But there's a scene in Indiana Jones. I always think about, you know, where he's standing in that abyss or that big, like, thing, you know, and he's going to walk out. There's a door on the other side. You guys know what I'm tracking with me? You know what I'm talking about? And he's got to get to that other side, but I don't even remember. I saw it when I was five, so. You know, but he has to go out, and there's something, I can't even remember, there's some reason he's just like, he needs to go. He needs to, like, go by faith. And so he steps out, and boom. I just remember seeing that, and then when he's out here, he's like, oh, shoot, I can see this bridge now. Like, I couldn't see it from here, but as I stepped out, like, just the way the shadows and everything shifted, now he saw it. You know, I love that picture of it, because I'm like, that's kind of how, you know, when the Lord tells us to step out sometimes, like, I don't see it, honestly. And then when we read these promises, we read these things, and he maybe keeps putting it on our heart, we're like, ah. And then when we step out, it's like, oh, I totally see it now. You know, I see it, and plus, you caught me. I didn't fall to my death. That's good. You know, and you see it, and then he's like, okay, I can walk in this. So we're to walk in him by faith. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God, the Bible says. I'll say, if you're trying to walk by faith and you're not in the word, you're not receiving from the word, it's going to be really hard. It's going to be really hard. Your faith's going to, you're just going to be like, you know what? I don't know, this whole thing, this whole living for God thing, it's just not working out. So you got to be in the Word. So walk in Him daily. Walk steady in Him. And now we get to this part where it says, rooted and built up in Him and established in the faith. Rooted and built up in Him. So my first point here for us as a church, and that I think of for us as I've always thought of for the youth, just so important, such a pivotal time, is that we would be rooted together. So, slide. There it is. Rooted together. Psalm 1 talks about that we'd be like a tree planted by rivers of water. You know, that our roots would be strong. It was, I took my boys on a little walk yesterday on the coast, and we're in, I think, Moss Beach, and there's all those trees up on the top, and the cliffs just keep falling away. Like, they just will slide off down into the ocean. It's crazy. So we hopped over that little fence. Just don't tell my wife about this. Oh, hey. No, we went, you know, it's not super famous. So we went over, and, you know, we're kind of like, man, it's crazy. It's a beautiful view. But you can literally look along the coast and see just sections that have fallen off. So we're by a section by a big tree. You know, I was telling them, hey, these roots here from this tree, these actually help stabilize the ground now. You know, so the roots were dependent upon the soil initially to get going and find nutrients and grow. But now it's reciprocal. These roots are actually holding the soil up now. They're holding the earth together. You know, and I kind of thought about that as men. I've always thought this verse is so great for the youth group, and like, man, rooted deep. I want them to have deep roots in the Lord and be established and strong. And I'm like, man, this is interesting. Because I know they've been a blessing today. And I know when God works through the youth, it's amazing. He often does His greatest work through young people. And it's a beautiful thing to see. And it's reciprocal. It's like sometimes the soil, the church, it's like we need to see that. Sometimes those roots will hold things together for us. And I thought it was a good picture of how, that, you know, just with transitional things going on right now, man, how those roots, not only for the youth, but for all of us, how they'll help hold the soil together, the soil of this church, of what God wants to do. They're going to hold things together, hold each other together. Roots are obviously vital for growth. So if you didn't know that, there you go. Roots are vital for growth. We all know that. It says roots. They have a few purposes. Roots act like straws, absorbing waters and minerals from the soil. And tiny root hairs stick out of the root, helping in the absorption. So that's cool. And then it says roots help to anchor the plant in the soil so it does not fall over. And roots also store extra food for future use. And so I thought that, man, that's beautiful. Like, Lord, this analogy of what You want us to be in truth in You is beautiful. Talks about water. You know, the roots, they go down to get the water, like straws for the water and the nutrients. That's like us. We need to be rooted in God's truth, in His Word. You know, the Bible's called like the living water to our soul. It, again and again, the Bible is talked about, His truth is talked about as water. That Christ, like a wellspring that flows out from us. Just that living water. Told the Samaritan woman at the well, hey, look, if you drink from the waters of this world, you're going to be thirsty again. Because that's just how it is. You weren't made for anything temporary. You were made for that which is eternal. And I can only satisfy that eternal thirst. He said, I am the living water. Anyone who drinks of Me will never thirst again. And so it talks about water being that we would be rooted and get that water of the Word of God's truth. It talked about being anchored, that roots help us be anchored, right? The Sermon on the Mount is pretty much Jesus talking about, hey, how to anchor your life to the rock, because storms are going to come and the winds are going to beat against you and the rains are going to come torrentially sometimes, and it's going to... this is real life. Like, these things are going to hit you. They're going to happen. So you need to be anchored. So that's why we need these roots. And then the roots also store food for use. Just face it, we eat a lot at church. You know, we have food after for us. We love to eat. Eating is probably just one of the coolest things in life. You know, just being able to eat together, have taste buds, that's all good. So I just wanted to throw that in there as that's a bonus. Like we get to fellowship. A lot of fellowships based around food. Often Jesus was eating with people. You just get able to connect with people through food. So, and I want to say roots grow better in good soil. Roots grow better in good soil. And so as we think about where we're planting our roots, what kind of soils we're planting them. And I thought about for kids in the youth group, but we could apply this to any of us, just whatever your soil is. So for these young people, it's home. Home is a soil. What's that soil like at home? School. School is a soil. Spend a lot of time there. What's that soil like at school? Kind of things are being absorbed at school with friends, right? With friends. That's a soil that they're surrounded with as they're growing in life. What kind of friends are there around them? And then church. Well, my heart, my desire is that this would be a place of good soil, that roots would grow deep for all of us. And there's two factors that kind of factor the root is there's climate and there's soil compaction. So when we think about climate, we obviously can relate that to climate. Well, what the weather's like, is it rainy, foggy, does it need a lot of rain, is it a sunny place? You know, what kind of things impact the soil? And soil compaction, that the soil can't be too loose and it can't be too tough. And this made me think, I've heard it said that when you raise somebody or a kid or, you know, just try and mentor someone, that it's like grabbing a bar of soap, you know, and you try and grab that and you don't want to grab it too hard and just force all kinds of things on them because it's going to shoot out. But you don't want to just like dead fish hold it, you know, like all limp and it's just going to slide out. You know, you got to have just that right grasp on it. And that's like this soil, that the soil can't be too loose. If the soil is just too loose, the roots, they're never going to get good traction. They're never going to be anchored to anything. You know, if everyone's like, oh, yeah, you can read if the Bible wants, you know, it's somewhat important to me, but not that important. And if our church isn't a place that honors the word, that reveres it, that holds it higher than anything else, that, man, that's the soil we want here, that we don't want it too loose, where we're just kind of cavalier about the things of God and just, but we don't want to be the other way either, too tight or too compact, where we try and force everything on someone. Oh, they got to think just like me, and, you know, let's force that idea down them, and oh, they just don't get it, forget it. No, we got to be a church that is a balance between those. Is balance, that this would be good soil for all of our roots to grow together. Not too loose, but we honor the things of the Lord, and not too closed off and tight, that we would be quick to listen, you know, and put ourselves in shoes of what other people are going through. Galatians 6 talks about how to restore someone. When someone falls into sin, hey, you restore them gently, you know, with love and considering yourself, lest you yourself be tempted. There's a gentle way to go about it, to speak truth in grace with them. Does anybody know the largest tree in the world? Biggest tree? Right? Heard it? Redwoods? Sequoias? Sequoias are number two. Redwoods are number one, right? They're local. They look like that, actually. So What I like about this slide, this is a local place. We could all go here in a matter of hours. You know, but redwoods are the biggest tree, tallest trees in the world. They're tall. They carve holes through these trees to drive through them. You know, these are big trees. The Ewoks, I think, live in these trees, I've heard. I've seen it on video. It's got to be true. You know, they're huge trees. They're massive. I don't know if you've gone and seen these trees, but they're really big. You know, and you could, like, get your friends and make a ring around them holding hands. All kinds of fun stuff to be had with these trees. But these are really big trees. It says redwoods have a really large root system. So I think that's kind of, we would agree to that they have a large root system. That makes sense because they're massive. And they often extend 100 miles. 100 miles. But the interesting about a redwood tree is they don't, I used to say, you know, these verses, if you've known me, I actually changed it up last night, so this was it. I used to always say, like, rooted deep, built up strong. Rooted deep, built up strong, baby. You know, but I was reading about these redwoods, the roots don't really go very deep at all. They don't go very deep, but you know what they do? They just go under, and then they go out. And if you've ever been to the redwoods or the sequoias, you'll notice they grow close together. So the reason that they can grow so big and so tall and so strong is not because their roots are just like, hey, independently me, this is my life, boom, I'm just gonna go really down. I love this because they grow together. They like get down and like, all right, where's the other tree? Oh, I need you, and then I need you. And then they intertwine and it's just crazy. Nothing can knock these over. I mean, sure, they fall over once in a while from disease and stuff, but it's pretty rare, you know? Or if you carve a big hole in it, maybe it might fall and drive your car. You know, but they're super strong trees because their roots grow together. And it says they intertwine like 100 miles. They can't even tell, like, I don't know if this root 100 miles is actually part of this tree over here. You can't tell. You know, as all the studies that have been done, they just don't know. I mean, it's unlikely that a root would actually go 100 miles. But it's just so connected once you get down there and they become so strong together. It says baby redwoods often sprout out at the parents' base latching onto their roots for nutrients. For this reason, they often grow in circular clusters, sometimes called fairy rings. So just get rid of the fairy rings. We don't wanna roll with that too long. But they're in clusters, they grow together. You know, and so the biggest tree, we look at its roots and we see it grows together. And that is exactly how the church is supposed to be as well. That our roots would grow together. I think, I believe that God would want to use our lives for maximum impact and potential in this life. You look at the parable of the talents. God doesn't just want us to bury what we have and who we are and all that and be like, oh, I'm just gonna wait till he returns. You know, tell him out of here. No, he wants us to invest that, to use it, to multiply it, to grow, to have impact, to be used, to bring his kingdom here, to bring the gospel, to bring good works, to bring healing, restoration, to bring social justice, all these great things we can align with. God wants us to do that. He wants us to grow up strong like these redwoods. And I love it because they're rooted together. And as a church that God wants to use to be strong, that our roots, all of our roots collectively would be intertwined. Hey, they may not be too deep, but those redwoods, they connect. And they grow together. And that our roots would, all of us, from the youngest of us to the oldest of us. One of my hopes and prayers of this church is that there would just be such seamless community that I'm sending Liam out with, you know, whoever, Mike Franks, to go put the signs and they're high-fiving and, you know, just youngest, oldest, intertwining, fellowshipping, discipleship, encouraging one another. You know, everybody is needed. Everybody is needed. It's all hands on deck when it comes to the church. And I love that. Everyone has a role to play. If someone just slips out, oh, I'm not needed, I'm not. The body's going to feel that. the body will feel that loss. So that we would be rooted together. It's always been my prayer for the youth, and it is my prayer for the church as a whole. And then he says, rooted and built up in him. Rooted and built up in him. So that's the next point, is that we would be built up strong. Built up strong. So this is another local landmark. We just have a beautiful place here that we love. Great things going on. Another, and that's obviously the Golden Gate Bridge being constructed. I love that thing. 11 people died in the building of that bridge. Crazy. Like, no safety nets for like half the time. People, like, I don't know how they did it. Just way up there. You know, a lot of work. The bridge that they said that it couldn't be built because that current is so strong. You can't put a tower out in the ocean in that current. It's just too strong. So they had to go deep, obviously, with that foundation. They had to hit bedrock with that foundation to get the South Tower to be planted there. And it's still there. And we love that thing. And it's probably one of the most photographed landmarks in all the world. And I love this because he transitions from rooted to now being built. Rooted to being built. And I love the juxtaposition of that you think rooted, you think natural, organic, this is in the dirt, these are flowing, you just add the water and the roots do their thing and they go any which way they want and they connect and it's beautiful and then they suck up nutrients into the tree's healthy. That's kind of organic, you know, and that's like, you know, obviously God does the work in us as we just are faithful to be in his word, to fellowship, to seek him. He will be there. He will cause the growth. You know, the Bible says that one plants and one waters, but God alone gives the growth. So any growth in your life as a Christian, that's God doing that. It's organic. He brings that growth. And I love this kind of transition into built. So we have the rooted. You know, where are those roots going to go? All the things going to do, but and you have this now being built up. You know, and I think about it sometimes as like this root, all these roots going down with like this building, you know, coming out the top. And when I think built, I think more hands-on. You know, when you're building something, it's more hands-on. It's like, okay, how are we going to angle this? Well, let's start with a plan here. Let's put some drawings together. What are we going to do here with this building? There's thought that goes into it. There's work that goes into it. I've been in the construction industry for a long time, and I'm currently like not so much in it right now, but there's hard work that has to get done to build something. And you got to roll up your sleeves, you got to get busy and get hands-on and be thinking about it. There's projects that go on where superintendents running a building project that's going up, where they're so integral and just so much stuff happens on a project and superintendents just have so much of the knowledge in their head, it's like it's not even written anywhere. It's just because I've been living and breathing this project for a long time. So there's jobs that happen where superintendents in the contract it's written that you can't even fire them. You know, you can't fire them because there will be so much in their head. Little things here and there. Oh, yeah, there was a pipe that we laid over there 3 weeks ago, and it's not on the plans, but, you know, there's just so much that is there. And even if the company, the contractor on the project gets, like, kicked off, that superintendent goes to the next company. It's just like they stay. Like, they're super important of the building of that project. And that we would engage as well. That we would engage in this built process. I think of, you know, salvation is, there's no works you do for salvation, right? It's been said you work, you don't work for salvation, you work from it. Like there's nothing you need to do to be saved except receive. It's like God's handing a gift, salvation is a gift. He hands it down, you just say, okay, I'll receive this. That's what salvation is. It's a gift of God, it's beautiful. But then as a Christian, once you're saved, there's like work that God wants you to do. There's good works that God wants you to do from that. Okay, great, yeah. All right, you're in the business. Jesus, when he was a kid, he was about his father's business. He was busy about his father's business. You know, the Bible says that there's good works for us to walk in them, and so that we would get busy and get dirty doing those things, that we'd roll up the sleeves. God, what do you have? How do you want me to build? And as I think about not only the youth, every life, we have the potential to build something in that life, to add some wisdom, to mentor, to disciple, to encourage, to speak into. We have that ability. I think of all the industries that there are and all the ways to make a living, all the good things of industry and professions and all this, and I'm often like, man, everything's going to fade except people. That's what has drawn me to ministry all my life. It's like, yeah, I could do this, but man, it's all temporary. But people. God, you want to build your church. It's not about this building, as awesome and beautiful as this building is and location. It's about people. It's about the people that are going to come into here. God, how can you build us? Because you're ultimately going to be doing it, but how do you want to use us? What gifts and talents and abilities have you given us to do that? How can we get busy building? Who are we discipling? Who are we encouraging? Who are we reaching out to? As crazy as the construction industry can be, and you know, you hear stories if you're not in it, you know, I've been in it, and just, you know, there's hours, and there's some projects where, like, that superintendent, he can be so consumed with that project. He's up early, he's up late, he's just, you know, he can't take vacation because he's on that project, and there's projects like that. And I've talked to supers like that and been like, okay, obviously they like building, you know, they're good at it, those things, but it's like, why go through all that? Why do all that and sacrifice so much time and energy and, you know, long hours and hard work and kind of babysitting other contractors, maybe it feels like sometimes, but why do that? And it's like the response is so that when I go by that building and it's done, and 5 years later, I can say, see that building? Yeah. I helped build that. It's been always a response as I've talked with you. What? Yeah. I helped build that. Man, I poured into that. Man, my sweat. You don't even know the things I poured into that. And I think about that with people. Us, with the youth, with the church. And I just want to encourage everybody, including myself. Like, let's help build people up strong. Just think about real quick. Jesus told us one thing to do before he left. He gave us the Great Commission. All right, go into all the world, preach the gospel, you know, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. It's like the one thing. And he said, and by the way, I'll be with you through all that. I will be with you. I just want you to think and ask, who are you discipling in your life? Who are you helping their roots grow together and growing together with? And who are you helping build up strong? Playing a role in that. And that we all would, at some level, have that desire. God, he wants to use you. I know he does. He said he does. His church is his body. And to see his church fully thriving and mobilized and engaged and doing the hard things at times, because discipleship is not easy. Much like building up, discipleship is not easy. It's not. But God wants to do that. He wants to do it, and then so that we could say, man, that life, I got to pour into that. You don't know the sleepless nights or the blood, sweat, and tears that went into that time together, but I got to pour into that. I got to be a part of what God was doing in another life for a positive aspect, to build them up, to encourage them, to lift them as high as they could go, rooted and built up in Him, in Christ, and established in the faith, that God would use us for that. That's been my great hope and desire for my life. It will be. It's been my great hope and desire for the youth. It's been my great hope and desire for the church, that we would just get out of the way of what we think sometimes and just let God enter in. And with us, make sure our roots are growing together. Make sure God's building us up strong. Because it happens together. It's the only way it happens is together. He's put people in your life for a reason. He's put this church in your life for a reason. And that God would do this in and through us. That He would establish us in the faith. Our roots would be strong, and they wouldn't be like my neighbor's old tree. I got a call a while ago, and there was a tree next in the yard next to us, and it was like a perfect tree for a treehouse. Kind of opened up flat, all the branches went out. It was cool. I actually wanted to build a treehouse in there, but it wasn't on my property. I'm like, hey, build a, can I do that? And yeah, of course not. But it looked great, you know, it looked strong. And we're at church one day and I get a call from my neighbor who, you know, doesn't call much. So I was like, okay, what's going on? And he's like, hey, I don't know where you're at, but you might want to come home. I said, what happened? He's like, well, the fire department's here. They're on your roof. They're like cutting a hole in your roof. A tree fell on your house. And I was like, oh man, I'm picturing like firemen tearing up my house and going to town on it. So we go and we get there and this tree just fell over in some wind. All, you know, kind of on my house, not too bad, didn't damage it too bad. And it was like, whoa, it was quite a sight to behold, this tree. What happened? You know, and we walked around to the root ball of it, and we saw that it's like sawdust. There was no roots here. These roots hadn't been doing their thing. You know, they weren't growing deep. They weren't growing together. They weren't getting nutrients up. There was something wrong with it. And we went on. It's just like, man, this tree just kind of looked good for a while. Like, oh, build a treehouse in me. You know, I'm awesome. You know, it's looked good for a while, but the roots weren't there to support it when those winds came. And I was like, man, that, I just don't know. Don't know what the roots are like. You know, the kind of that vision M had during camp, it was like, man, that we wouldn't be this flower that looks nice, and you pull it out, and it's like, oh my gosh, it's all rotted, and those roots are moldy, and dying, but that our roots would be strong. And this is something most of us won't see in one another. We won't see it. We won't see your roots. We won't know really your devo time, how you're pursuing the Lord on your own. Are you pursuing the Lord? Like, we won't see all that a lot of the time, because we're often to go and do that on our own. Like, man, I need to go meet God face to face. And to carve out time to go and do that. So in our life, sometimes we can it can look really nice, really good, until that wind may come and knock it over. And I believe that God is and wants to do a great work in this church. And everybody here, I truly believe that God wants us to be rooted together. That there would be strength that would allow us to grow up strong. And that we would be built up. That there would be work done. That we would roll up our sleeves and get busy. And it doesn't happen overnight, but that we would continue to do what God's called us to do and be the people that he's called us to be. So I'm going to ask Kissy to come up, close us out in worship. Father, I thank you for this morning. God, I thank you for Lord, what you're doing. Lord, your hopes, your plans, your desires for us. God, I pray that we would be rooted in the truth of your word. God, I pray that you would root us together in fellowship, as a church, as a body. Lord, I thank you that you have done so much of that, Lord, that this church is like a family, that we know one another, we can be there for one another, that there's prayer for one another, we're going to walk with other people through the difficult times, be there with them for the good times. Lord, all knowing, God, that this life is so brief, God, that you would grow us together, Lord, build us up strong in who you are and who you've called us to be. So, Lord, I thank you. Lord, I pray that your Spirit would fill this place as we close out in worship. Lord, that we could assess the roots in our life. Lord, only we know, really. Only we know. There's so much depth to people. So many layers to us. Very, very few probably know us through a lot of those layers to the core of who we are, Lord. And only we really know those roots and where those are going and what those roots are sinking in, what kind of soil those are in. And you can build something good for a while, but we all know the foundation needs to be strong for it to endure. God, I know there's so many people that are a part of this fellowship in this church, God, that have roots that are so deep. Roots that are so deep that we need to make sure we're rooted next to them and with them. And we're gleaning from their wisdom and from their insights and from their life, a life walked with you and a life that they've been walking with. God, and I pray that everything built up, Lord, everything we do see, everything seen by the eye of coming up from the ground, God, I pray it would be stable. It would have strong foundation. Lord, it would be awesome. It would be beautiful. It'd be cool. It'd be a wonder to look at. A building that is just, man, that's a work of art. So God, I thank you for who you are, or that you do this. So we ask that you would do this now, through this time of worship. Lord, I thank you so much for the mountaintops, like the one we had at camp. And as Nish said, that the fruit grows in the valley. We enter back in, we apply everything we've learned, and those roots that have gone deeper, and a few more floors you want to put on that building. We pray this in Jesus' name.
I'll stand in awe.
ushers forward. We pray for tithe and offering, and just know that God loves a cheerful giver. You're visiting, and don't feel compelled, but and everything that you're giving to the church, but you're giving through the church. That we have the chance to align with what God's doing, align with His heart, His vision for the world, and bring the gospel and help rescue, redeem, and restore. So that's what this is used for. That's what we're doing here. And we'll collect the tithe through this next song. And Father, we pray that you would just bless what we take here. Lord, this isn't just no ill thoughts here, God. We want to be able to do great good. Lord, to meet tangible physical needs of so many. God, Lord, we want to be able to do that. Lord, we want you to be glorified. Lord, we want people to see our good works and glorify our Father in heaven. So we just pray for the tithe and offering that you would place upon hearts whatever people would want to give cheerfully. Lord, knowing that you own 100% of everything that you allow us to get. Lord, you've given us our health, you've given us our influence, you've given us our abilities, you've given us the timing of certain decisions we've made, of the opportunities we've had. So thank you, Lord, for those. Thank you. Lord, bless your people, Lord, as they give. Lord, is this an act of worship to give the tithe, the tenth, or whatever you place upon our hearts, Lord. There's also communion up here, and Kissy's going to do some more songs. I encourage you guys to stay, to worship, to respond, to seek the Lord, to write something down, to look for a verse that's on your heart or mind, to maybe text someone that's on your heart and mind that God's placed there, to maybe resolve something. Lord, this is what I want to do stepping away from today. This is maybe something that you've put on my heart. I would encourage you guys to take communion together as families or whoever you want. We'll just allow you to take as you want on your own together. We won't take together corporately, but come up as you feel led, and you can take the elements and take them with those around you, or if you want to go, just take them by yourself. It's up to you. But we do it in remembrance of the Lord. We do it as believers. We encourage you, if you don't know the Lord, that you wouldn't partake in communion. We also encourage you, if you don't know the Lord, that you would come to know the Lord. His invitation is extended to you, and it's a prayer of repentance and trust and receiving the gift of salvation, that He bore the cross for our sins. That He paid a debt He didn't owe, because we owed a debt that we couldn't pay. We can never do enough good to make enough right, to be right before a holy and righteous God. And Christ bore that for us, to rescue, to redeem, to then restore us here, to root us and build us. Father, again, I just thank you for this morning, God, that you would have your way in us. Thank you for this time that we get to continue in worship and communion and taste forgiveness and the price that you gave for us, the ransom for our sins. God, open our eyes this morning. Encourage us, Lord, that this would be a springboard to lead us into our week with the right perspective, calibrated. And Lord, so we thank you. In Jesus' name.
nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me
Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. You claim the victory, God. It belongs to you. You claim our lives, Jesus. We belong to you. Lord God, may we abide in you. You are the vine. We are the branches. May we stand in awe of you. May we stand tall, Lord Jesus, without fear. Please, Jesus, we pray you would break the strongholds of the world in our lives, God. The sin that holds us back from truly living lives for you, glorifying you. God, teach us, God, to let it go. You have something far greater than we can ever imagine. So, Father, open our eyes. Open our eyes, God, that we may see you, that we may trust you, that we may hope in you, that we may love you fully, God. We call ourselves Christians. May we live it, not act it. May we live it. May we think it. May our hearts go deeper than facade, than surface joy, surface love, surface playing at Christian. God, give us honesty and integrity, and may we be built on that, God. Be the very source of love, the source of joy that radiates out of our lives. Lord, we say hallelujah. You are great. You are holy, and you are wonderful. You have won the victory. Let's sing that again. Hallelujah. Holy, holy God Almighty. He's a great I am. Who is worthy, none beside thee, God Almighty, is great I am. Hallelujah, holy, holy, God Almighty, is great I am. God, that you would take hold of our lives the minute that we step outside of this church, God, that we would not go back to our old ways, but may we be new and alive in you, God. Lord Jesus, fill us with passion at the sound of your name. Fill us with love and a fervor and a yearning for your word, God. And may we grow deep with one another together, Lord Jesus, lifting one another up in prayer, God. Seeking outside of ourselves and our present situations and seeking out other people and praying for them. Father, place those opportune moments in our lives, God. Do away with us, God. Have your way in us, Lord Jesus. We praise you. We worship you. Light us up, God. Light us up on fire. And may we light others on fire in your name. Lord God, we love you. We praise you and we glorify your name. In Jesus' name, amen.